So I wanted to say one thing because it's on my mind all the time right now. In the historical moment that we're in the neighborhood that we're in the reality that we're in, of what art is good for. And the thing I go back to is in 2008 I saw Rigo speak at the New Museum as a part of a Creative Time project organized by Mark Beasley. He was in discussion with Robert King Wilkinson and Golden Three, and it was a really, really special talk. And at the end of it, there was a kind of aggressive question that was, why is this happening in an art museum? Why isn't this happening on the steps of Congress? Why isn't this happening in schools? Why isn't this? And King gave a really great answer about Emory Douglas and about the work that Emory Douglas did for the Black Panther Party, but I wanted to read a little bit of Rigo's answer, because it is, as I question what we're doing here, what I'm doing with my life in these kind of spaces, this is what I cling to in these moments. So anyway, what Rigo said is, it's hard not to be overcome with a sense of futility. The realm where a lot of my actions appear is the realm of the symbolic, trying to speak back or to inspire. With the Angola 3 case, it seems so outrageous that something like this could go on and not make a huge noise. I thought that if you pay attention to this, it would spread like a disease. Instead, all of a sudden, it just goes whoop, and you have Guantanamo, Abu Ghraib, and it's like you are standing in the middle of the road and a teenager on a motorcycle comes by really fast, and you want to point out how this behavior can be potentially dangerous, and pretty soon a train comes by, and this crazy traffic has been going on, but it still doesn't seem to attract attention. I think at some point I got overwhelmed by the distractions, and that's what led me to Robert's case. Instead of making art, I tried to work with Robert and to be in situations where I could see that something was being done. And I just want to skip to the end, where he says, it's a collective enterprise, and being an artist doesn't give me any more responsibility to do anything about it. Actually, it's one of the weakest starting points. If I were a doctor, an engineer, or a lawyer, I would be at a better starting place. Being an artist just happens to be what I do. So that is a really tough place to end. But I will follow up that I was there with my sister, who was a bike messenger in San Francisco for a long time. And when she brought up, I'm sorry, what she brought up is, when she was messengering in San Francisco, which is not an easy thing to do, and like, she ruined her knees, and she was always miserable in the rain and the hills, is she would intentionally reroute herself to see Rigo's One Tree mural, and just like this little glimmer, and the importance of that. And I think there's a lot more beyond those little glimmers, but I feel like that's a really good starting point for us and for this talk, so I just wanted to share it. Thank you, Rigo. I'm going to walk away now. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Ethan. Thanks for the invitation to come here. This is my microphone.
I'm going to turn up a little bit.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for everyone for coming. There's so many familiar faces here, so I feel safe. I guess I'm going to try and go a little bit into the part of the iceberg that's not visible right now in terms of what I do. So I was lucky to find some images that I think I wasn't sure I'd be able to find. So I'm hoping just to do a little bit of background about what this project came about. And I met Ethan when he was at the New Museum in New York City, working with Bunchy Chu, was a dear friend, and we became affiliated, or we became connected then. And Ethan was having a concert, I think the night of the show that Emory Douglas did there, or the night after, and I went and I got to see him perform. And then, you know, it feel like 5 minutes go by, but then it's like, oh, it's been 12 years, or it's been 7 years. So, I think it's beautiful when you have connections with people that time becomes really so hard to measure, you know? So this is a drawing I made for a publication out of South Africa, but it's called Chimurenga, which means struggle, and was an illustration for the magazine. It's a magazine that's the byline is "Who no no go no." And it's a line from a Fela Kuti song, "Who no no go no." And the people who put out this journal think it's a very wonderful expression, because it means that ignorance is curable. we don't know, don't know. And so there was a sculpture that I did recently. It is called Text in the Visionary Called Boys Safely Contemplating the Future. It was a response to the right to carry guns, whatever you want to. And, you know, I live in Burbank now, not far from here, and on my way to get a coffee, I still see a wooden portrait of a Native American in a cigar store. I guess, kid you not, this is 2017. They still have the cigar store Indian. So I kind of mimicking the same aesthetics. I did this sculpture. The first time I showed in LA was at the Watts Labor Community Action Committee. And it was an exhibition dedicated to Geronimo Chijaga. Geronimo was the Minister of Defense for the LA chapter of the Black Panther Party. And I was painting a mural in Oakland, and part of the mural was calling Geronimo innocent. And then some neighbors called me over after seeing me there for a few days, and they were like, "Where do you live?" I said, "I live in the Mission in San Francisco." They both started laughing, and one says, "Yeah, didn't I tell him he doesn't even live here?" And then they're like, "Does Geronimo know you're doing this?" And I was like, "No." They go, "Well, you should write him." And I took Bart back home, and I was completely flabbergasted. Like, what do they mean I could write him? I mean, the idea that one could just write like a person that for me is like an historical figure, like Geronimo. But I did do it. I wrote Geronimo. It was at Mule Creek State Prison at the time. And he brought me back, and still one of the biggest joys I've ever had, you know. Picking up an envelope, it says in the front, "Nuguru Rigo," which I later found out is a Swahili greeting. So we became acquainted, and I did an exhibition dedicated to him in 1996 that was called Time and Time Again, in the Bay Area in Richmond. And a good friend of mine, whose name is Mark Shyatt, and is in the audience, and he's probably going to be upset that I'm mentioning him, but he offered to print a little catalog for the show dedicated to Geronimo. It's like, man, I got so many people, but I know in the advertising world they can run this at the end of the job, no problem, people with the photos. So I just took quotes from Geronimo's letter, and Mark put a catalog together, which of course was very, very beautiful, very simple, very beautiful. And I gave about 10 copies of that catalog to Geronimo's wife. And Geronimo's wife sent one of those catalogs to the first lawyer that had represented him. A young law school kid, straight out of law school, that went to visit Geronimo, and Geronimo said, "Man, I've been framed by the government, and the police are fucking me over, blah, blah, blah." And the lawyer's like, "Man, you're cuckoo." Anyway, this lawyer's name was Johnny Cochran. So Johnny Cochran had just come from winning the case representing O.J. Simpson, and I think actually that catalog arriving at his office played a role in him deciding to take, I don't think I've ever told him, played a role in him deciding to take over the representation of Geronimo. And of course, there was one lawyer that stayed with Geronimo throughout, and it was a Jewish lawyer called Stuart Hamlin, so he's the one that actually represented, stuck with Geronimo throughout. But then Cochran came in, and because of the capacity that he had at that point. And then Orange County judge that had been appointed by Ronald Reagan, so conservative judge, I guess, is the one that released Geronimo. He went to trial and they released him. So the exhibition was scheduled to open on July 1st, 1997, and Geronimo was released on June 10, 1997. So like, oh shit, what are we going to do now? The exhibition was supposed to be called Time and Time Again, you know? So quick, you have to like change everything, change the name to Guilty Until Proven Innocent. By the way, the person that did the lettering here was a sign painter from Watts is a Vietnam veteran who had lost one arm. So he only had one arm. The other arm was completely gone to the shoulder. And it was really incredible to see this man work with like a hand with all the pencil and the ruler. And so he's the one that drafted that. Well, July 1st, it just so happened, was the Mike Tyson Holyfield fight. And Geronimo being Geronimo, as soon as he got out of prison, Marlon Brando offered him an SUV. So Geronimo was driving around in an SUV, and somebody called him and said, hey, you know, Mike Tyson Holyfield fight, we get you ringside tickets and a private jet, you know? And this is it, WCLC is the people running it, these two brothers that are the brother and sister, the children of the founder of the space. Anyway, Terrell Watkins is the person that I dealt with. We're installing the show last day, and she comes in. We're trying to reach Geronimo. And I'm like, so did you get a hold of it? She goes, I talked to Geronimo's people. So what did he say? Well, he said if you can get him a TV to see the fight, that he'll come here instead of going to Las Vegas. And I'm like, what did you tell him? I told him we'd have the biggest motherfucking screen in the ghetto, and fools could stay home, pay 30 bucks to sip a beer, or come here and be part of history. I was so excited, I stopped installing, I went home, you know, took a shower, my friend Carter, smoked a joint, drank a beer, and then I took the shower first, he was going to take the shower after. And I said, man, I'm going to lay down, and then get me up. And he's like, oh, don't worry, okay, sure. And then I lay down, and the next thing I hear is like, Rigo. I'm sorry, man. I turned. We missed the opening. I was like, man, that's so not funny, you know? I turned my head the other way, and I look out the window, and sure enough, it was pitch dark. And I was like, oh, I mean, I didn't know what I wanted to do to him, and, you know? So we get in this little rental car, we go there, and everybody's looking at us, where were you? Run, he's up there, run. I'll never forget, I literally ran into this warehouse where they had been projecting the fight, and all I see is this big, huge face of a black man with what appeared to be a piece of his ear missing. And then I look down, and there's another, like, you know, bald, shaved head, African-American man, and there was G, you know? And that's, I met Geronimo, and he told me, Rigo, this is what you do. Your job is to spread information and free all political prisoners. So I kind of took that as a homework assignment. And I've spent not all of my time, but a good part of the time doing that kind of work. There was a press conference before, when the judge released Geronimo, and that's Stuart Hanlon in the back, and you can see this is Jeannie, this is Geronimo's sister, and behind you that's Dennis Banks with the vest and Floyd Westerman, the American Indian Movement, and Leonard's cousin. So the relationship between the cases is obviously direct. Is that Geronimo's two children, which were conceived from behind bars, and his granddaughter. He later had another child that was born in Kilimanjaro Mountain in Tanzania. And, you know, we drove from San Francisco when we heard there was a chance that Geronimo might get released. We drove down, so I actually took this photograph. LAPD, FBI, COINTELPRO frame up. So Geronimo got a settlement, I think it was about $4 million. $2,250,000 from the LAPD and $750,000 from the FBI for framing him and robbing him of 28 years of his life. When he came out of prison, there was Lakota drummers. Boom, 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 boom. And one of the journalists turned to them and went like that. It's kind of like an unfortunate gesture, but it's meant to not make noise. And Geronimo said, no, man, this is so auspicious that I should be hearing native drums as I walk out of prison. My father, of course, he in Indian. And he was released, but there was a possibility that they would appeal and he would have to go back to trial, so he was under orders not to leave the state. Somebody asked him, so, Geronimo, what's your plans? What you gonna do? Now, I said, man, I've always been a mama's boy. I'm gonna go see my mama. Which meant, the first thing he said is he was not gonna obey the rules of his release because his mother was in Louisiana. And he did do just that. Was an infographic, this was Geronimo's lifetime up until then. The time he spent outside of prison, the time he spent inside of prison. And when we set up this show in the Watts, it was interesting because I'd never been to Disneyland, but it was kind of set up in a way that, because most of their clients, their people that go there are high school students, so the idea was to set up a show in a way that people would walk through and then they'd tell you a story. You know? And the guy that was driving in the beginning to get supplies and stuff, he had just gotten out of prison recently. And he said, man, people won't understand this show unless they can see their faces behind bars. So then we did this mirror and bars in front. So when you came in, this is where the information was. You would see yourself behind bars. So the work was like a collaboration with the people that were there. Many different artists from the neighborhood participated. And Big Black was the nickname of one of the leaders of the Attica uprising. Curiously, he had been awarded a similar amount of $4 billion settlement for being tortured by the guards. So one of the panels said, 1997, Big Black awarded $4 million Attica victory. There's information, top 10 charges for which Californians are being imprisoned. Number one, possession of a controlled substance. Number two, possession of a controlled substance for sale. Number three, robbery. Number four, sale of controlled substance. Five, second-degree burglary, assault with a deadly weapon, driving under the influence, first-degree burglary, petty theft with prior, vehicle theft. In other words, murder and rape don't figure the top 10 reasons why people are in prison. We had a room dedicated to Emery Douglas's art. And there was a fax machine that people could write a letter and send a fax. This was 1997, and some more information. And then there was a wall dedicated to Leonard. So this was the first time that I dedicated a portion of an exhibit to Leonard Peltier. There was a wall where I represented 28 years of weeks. So each one of those groupings, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. You know, so representing 28 years. But I don't know how to represent, you know, how do you get across this idea for that much time. Many people came to the opening. That's Emery Douglas on the left. Sister Suljaya, she's the one that kept doing a shoot-in or shoot-out with the LAPD. She kept all the police at bay while all the male Panthers got away. That's Elder Freeman. I mean, the person next to Geronimo, I don't know, but I know that he went there with a broken foot. Elder Freeman and Muhammad on the right, he was Mike Tyson's bodyguard, which I find a very intriguing profession. And we did get to embrace, you know. That was the first time that I actually met in person after the one of the displays that they had there was this, you could look into what would be the inside of the slave ship. So they have a big mouth of somebody screaming, and you look into the mouth and you see the, I don't know what you'd call it, place that people would be carried. You know, I did some more work. This is in the time was a bookstore called 33 and a Third here in LA. And in San Francisco, dedicated this mural titled Truth to Robert King, who was a member of the Angola Tree that Ethan mentioned. At the dedication of, I dedicated the mural to him, and the city and county of San Francisco declared April 22nd, 2002 as Robert King Day in the city and county of San Francisco, which was nice. For the dedication, we gave away 200 bags of free groceries in a good painter fashion. Just as Robert King being greeted by Yuri Kuchihama, she's the woman that tried to give mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to Malcolm X after he got shot. Now you can be in a walker and still be fighting, you know. And that's David Hilliard, who was the chief of staff of the Black Panther Party in the hat. And by the way, that hat that Robert is wearing was knitted by Unji Ju, at the time director of Red Hat in LA. She also made me one. I'd love to share that story about Unji. And I did this sculpture. That was the only work that I did that would be similar to this Peltier statue. This is at San Jose State University, where John Carlos and Tommy Smith went to school. They're the athletes that did the Black Power salute, Mexico City Olympics. You know, the materials, the mix of materials, bronze and ceramic tile and concrete. I spoke to John Carlos earlier this morning, and I mentioned that we're going to be doing this talk, and could I call him? And because we're close, and he's actually said, "Oh man, my wife wants me running around this afternoon. I don't think you can get me, but you know, they want to make America great again. Tell them that they want to take us back to 1920 when we were in bondage." Now, there's this great thing called Poetry Slam. Youth Speaks, like a nationwide competition of young poets. And they had one of their finals in San Jose State University. And I really love this photograph. There's John Carlos there in the light blue and the hat. They made him sweaters that, based on the US Olympic team, but it said poet. It's really awesome. And while we were building the statue, which Mark and I drove one of them up, somebody else drove the other one. This was 2005, and Katrina had happened. By then, Robert King was living in New Orleans, and his house got flooded. He actually had recently gotten a dog, Kenya, and his partner was at work. So the flood happened, he goes upstairs, brings Kenya, and then people came to rescue him a bunch of times in canoes, and he would show up, and they're like, "Oh no, okay, please come, sir, we're not taking any pets." He's like, "All right, later." So he stayed there, I think, for a week with the dog. He would not leave the dog behind, and he actually broke into some of the neighbors' houses to release the dogs and that were chained and stuff like that. And eventually two friends got a canoe and broke through the police barricades, whatever had been set up, and went and got him on a canoe. So I hired Robert to help build the sculpture of Tommy Smith and John Carlos. Robert was helping us with the epoxy mix. And by the way, since then, Robert has gotten an honorary doctorate degree in law from Christ School of Law in Cambridge. So Dr. King, Dr. Robert King, please. So back to that, in 1999, I did this show at the Berkeley Art Museum. Because there are two things at the point in time which might still apply. Two aspects of life in which California absolutely stands out, and they are these two aspects. You know, so there's a lot of you know, nobody else makes more. Anyway, so I put up that banner. And then later that same year, the De Young Museum in San Francisco, the De Young was going to be torn down for this for a new building to be built there, by designed actually by Herzog and de Meuron, Swiss architectural firm. And Glenn Helfand was the curator for the show, and he invited a bunch of Bay Area artists to like think about the, you know, the role of the museum, what the museum could be like in the next century, blah blah blah. And the De Young has several, has collections, different collections like Oceania art, African art, European, you know, and they have a Native American collection. And you know, I was, it seems to make very little sense to so honor the past of a culture while utterly disrespecting its present. So I thought that in the future maybe the museum could be called Tadeu Kikua, which is Leonard Peltier's given name in Lakota, and means the wind follows the sun, or the wind chases the sun. So the De Young Museum is actually has a tower in the middle and two wings. One is the Nation Art Museum and the other one is like an emergency exit. So we painted it and added that signage as if it were a museum, but the door would be, of course, you couldn't go in. Those banners are taken from some of two of Leonard's paintings. And then on the inside there was a series of, because Leonard paints from prison. He's been painting for a long time. So along the same fashion as the show for Geronimo had been done, there was a timeline on the floor, so it started blocking in 1976. And then when you got to 1999, you were in the present moment and you were looking inside the cell where I had one of his self-portraits. Then we did a version of this show at the MAC, Museum of Contemporary Art in Rio, or Niterói. And I'm there with the Renato, he's a Guarani leadership, a young Guarani leadership from São Paulo. And Tony Zaiden, who was at the time the director of the Leonard Peltier Defense Committee. You know, at that point I was in contact with Tony quite a bit, and I was telling her, look, we're going to do this show in Brazil, we're going to bring Leonard's paintings there. And she was like, oh, are you standing up or are you sitting down? I said, I'm standing up. Well, I think you better sit down. Okay. So I sat down and she said, well, Leonard says for you to suggest some people for him to paint. And I was like, what? So I suggested Rigoberto Menchutun and Evo Morales, two native people from the same continent, one Nobel Peace Prize winner and the other one a head of state. Leonard Peltier, a prisoner in the United States. Painted the two paintings that the paint was still not fully dry. She was completely Tony was very, very fearful of flying. So she arrived in a total state of the lady was a mess, but she came and brought the paintings. And then we actually brought the painting to Guarani village where Renato's grandfather lives, and he is the person in charge of that village. He has been in charge of the village since he was 17 years old. He was 95 at the time. That painting has now been gifted to Evo Morales. Some years later, it was 2008 or something. This one is 2010. If I'm not mistaken, at the Warehouse Gallery at Syracuse University. Again, staging of the same exhibition of the Tadeu Kikua Museum. And here there's a quote from Art Lyons, who was the keeper of the faith for the Onondaga Nation in the East Coast. And he was the first person to address the Assembly General, the General Assembly of the United Nations in December 1992, when the UN announced that 1993 would be the International Year of the Indigenous People. And during his oration, during his speech, online and said, our brother, Leonard Peltier, has been too long in prison. This was in 1992. This is a, you know, very kind of like private photo of Angela Davis visiting the occupation of Wounded Knee. Was an announced visit, and that's Orange Lions facing the camera with the sunglasses. The photographer is this French lady called Michelle Bean. She was in her 80s when I met her. She was wheelchair bound. And we spent like 3 days going through her proof sheets. And it was really wonderful. All I had to pay for was the printing. I think it was like $19 or something each photo. She had donated the negatives to the Berkeley Museum. So among her photographs, I realized that she had all these photographs of native people making art behind prison. And like, oh shit, it's not just landing. So these are actually photos during the Alcatraz occupation. Even while occupying the island, they were making art. These are from Leonard at Leavenworth. And Dennis Banks actually making furniture in Springfield. So for this exhibit in Syracuse, it's the first time that I did a version of this sculpture. It was made out of clay and very temporary materials. And when I visited Wounded Knee, they had a little table where people sell their crafts. And there was this man called Leonard by coincidence, and he was selling these little drums. And the drums were made from government-issued tuna cans. Then he removed the bottom and the top. And then his wife used dental floss to stretch his skins onto the drums. And on one side, they would have 1890, the Wounded Knee Massacre. And on the other side, 1973, the occupation of the church. So I asked him, could he do one in each color, black, yellow, white, and red? And this is Tom Corbett, who was featured in the photograph that Ethan used for he came to Syracuse to speak during this show. The last time he had been in an airplane before that had been 33 years before. But Tom said, yeah, I'll come out there. He sang the AIM song. And then from there, the sculpture had to be broken up, and it's complicated because it didn't fit through the door. It was supposed to be destroyed, but they wanted to keep it. So we brought it to Niagara Falls, this small cultural center in the former high school, kind of pasted it back together. And that's Dennis Banks with the flat top hat, and Alan Jameson. You know, Dennis Banks is one of the historical leaders of the American Indian movement, and Alan Jameson is also a native activist. So the sculpture is based on this painting that Leonard painted from prison, where he's sitting down. So I used the painting as the starting point. And February 13 of last year, for the first time on Alcatraz Island, they welcomed back the original occupiers of the island between 1969 and 71. So I had made a little model of the sculpture because we're trying to like raise funds to be able to build it. So some of the ones that had been able to make it to the island, the group that was there, they took a photograph with the model. And then I got to attend the 15th session of the Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues at the UN, invited as a member of the American Indian Movement delegation, which was a great honor. And there we also took a photo with the indigenous delegates from different parts of the world with the little model of the sculpture. You know, and then this photo is actually in LA. Maureen was on her way to work and she heard on the radio, there's a protest in front of the LA City Hall calling for Leonard's release. So I drove there real quick and used the model and perspective to make it. It's a 9-inch model. But it was uncanny because they were talking, and then at the moment, without nobody saying anything, all the people that were there turned to the city hall and started rushing up the stairs. So it's like, what? They just ran up. So then the building of the actual sculpture was this one, the final size one, was the skin parts were rendered in redwood. And I was carving it and doing the work in my backyard. kind of scale. And Brandon is here, Engstrom, and yeah, without him, this statue would not have been finished, this sculpture would not have been finished, you know, without embarrassing anyone. But between Rafa and I, we reference Pulp Fiction. It's like Mr. Wolf arrived. we were able to finish, to clean up our mess and actually finish the sculpture. But it was wonderful, Brandon, thank you. It was uphill the whole time because, you know, I've never done anything like it. The components had to be smaller size because we were going to be driving it ourselves across the country. And the idea is that it could be reassembled. And, you know, I'm not a very good planner, so most people building a sculpture like this would start by the armature. I started by the feet. and actually there one day we were having a little gathering in the bike garden, Louise Steinman was here, she got up and stood on both of the feet, and I was like, ah, that's great, I took the photo and sent it to her. Well, it ended up turning into a thing on its own, and so the feet kind of became, in a way, the podium for the Thomas Smith and John Carlos, and a place where people could identify with his journey or walk on his shoes, quote unquote. So we then took the sculpture to several locations, and this one is when the dancers were coming back from the sunrise ceremony in Alcatraz on the hand Thanksgiving celebration that they had. So we got there, but we couldn't get on the boats to get to Alcatraz. About 1,000 people got turned back, which was really wonderful, because by then the elections had already happened, and it was cool to know that you have to catch the boat between 4:15 and 5:45 or something, and that 1,000 people got turned away, because people were just like looking for a way to do something that seemed right, you know. So I got really pissed because I was supposed to get on the boat, and I was like, oh man. So we just set up shop on the sidewalk and waited for people to come back. But it became pretty apparent, the power of the images. This was, by the way, a student, Ashley Forbes, she's from Dominican Republic. She stayed there stoically by the tripod for like 4 hours. I don't think she even went to the bathroom or anything. It's amazing. We got maybe like 400 people that stood on the feet. So then, as we're getting ready to leave, and I'm telling, you know, Mark, we're gonna leave, he's like, wait, but are the feet available now? Maybe we should try and show the feet and bring the feet somewhere in LA. We contacted Gina Lang, who is here as well, and she got us in touch with the Samia's Academy in El Sereno. And I think it was like from today to tomorrow kind of thing. They set it up and we were there and bought the feet. And many of the students there stood on the feet. This is an artist in residence that's there doing it for a 1 year residence to work on a play with the students. And then Caleb Duarte was a Chicano artist from Fresno. Him and a photographer took the feet, and I took the rest of the sculptures. So we rented a Penske truck. I went on Highway 40, and they went from Fresno to Oakland, to Pine Ridge Reservation, to Standing Rock Reservation, and to DC. So this photograph is in Pine Ridge. Tom Corbett, twice elected vice chairman of Douglas Lakota. He used to live in the Badlands, and he's like, man, I gotta be closer. So now he lives on that, in that trailer, and wounded at Wounded Knee. The day before yesterday, or the night, rather, the phone rang at 11:30 at night, and it was Tom. He was crying, he was drinking, and he needed to talk, you know. It was pretty moving, but it's just the nature of the situation. He told me, man, Rigo, I want my brother home. I need my brother home. You know, you made a statue, I can't do that. But one day, you know, one day, are you there? Are you listening? I'm listening, Tom. One day, man, one day we'll ride together. And us Indian people, we won't be second class no more. That's the feet by the cemetery at Wounded Knee. And then from Pine Ridge, they went to Standing Rock. And this was the weekend that the big blizzard came in. And that 2,000 veterans of the United States Armed Forces volunteered and paid their way to go there, grasping for something to do with their lives, you know, to protect the water protectors from people in uniforms that have been through much less than they have, and now much less than they do about weaponry and shit. So that was really kind of a game changer when they did that. The story behind this photograph is amazing. By the way, these photographs are by Mark Orris, who's a Catalan photographer who went from San Francisco to the tip of Chile on a bicycle with his girlfriend. So they were there, they had these feet, they were setting up at the camp in Standing Rock, and these two kids were seeing them and just like giggling, kind of making fun, like, you know, what the fuck is going on here? And then Mark reached out to them and he said, "Now we're doing this, this is for a sculpture of Leonard." And he said it was amazing, like the kids' faces completely just like changed. They immediately dropped and they were like, so they did that, they got up on the feet. This photo just came out, I think, so incredible, but I love this one. Like, what a great argument against comfort. He took his glove out. He took his glove off. You gotta feel the cold, you gotta feel the elements, man. You know, you can't stay comfortable and engage in struggle at a certain level. It's just not possible. So this heavy blizzard happened, and a lot of the elders and people were not dressed properly to stay on the camp. They went to the Standing Rock Casino, and what you're looking behind this gentleman does shaft the like highly sacred objects that usually are not allowed to be photographed. But upon explaining what they were doing, you can see that Scarlett's hand and foot is there, like, hoping that it's not going to fall, man, you know. And unfortunately, due to my ignorance, I don't know the names of these people in these photographs, but they are all very, very, they're like living treasures, they're very special people. I don't know, I cannot tell you who they are, but I can tell you that they were there, they were protected in the scene. He's a walker. He's walked across the United States, I don't know how many times, and this gentleman here, I think he's from Japan, the Buddhist monk that goes on these incredible, like, long walks for peace. And like, people are having fun. So then this is the dedication of the statue in D.C. at the Kasten Art Center. This is Len Foster, who's the spiritual advisor for Leonard Peltier, and he a long-term member of the American Indian Movement, but he was instrumental in bringing ceremonies to prisons, the right to have sweats, to the Freedom of Religion Act. So he did a beautiful oration in Lakota to protect the statue, to honor that moment. This is Robert King, who flew to D.C. even though he's just been in Europe for 3 weeks, flying all over the place with Albert Woodfox, recently released from 44 years in prison, most of them in solitary confinement. So Dr. Robert King was there, but Dr. Robert King was also one of the main funders for the sculpture. He has won a settlement, a civil suit against the state of Louisiana. And he's one of the supporters of the funders of the project. Chauncey Peltier is Leonard's eldest son, and he was in, there was a, that 1 week from December 5th to the 10th was, they organized a Leonard Peltier week in Washington, D.C. So he was there, as was his youngest brother, and that morning, Chauncey went to the hotel room to pick up his brother, and he found him lifeless. He had serious health issues, and he had died overnight from Thursday to Friday. And this was Friday afternoon, and he still came to the dedication of the sculpture, and he wasn't scheduled to talk, but he asked the microphone and spoke. He said, "Leonard, man, I hear a lot of people talk about Leonard. Leonard Peltier. I don't know Leonard. He's my father." So that's where the work was. Across the street, those brown buildings is the National Headquarters of Homeland Security. And you know, the reason given by the university to remove the statue was that they received threats of violence to the statue, nearby buildings, and people. Some of you might have seen this image of the removal of the statue. This is a detail from a painting that I showed a couple of years back at the Fowler Museum. My friend Sebastian works. A couple of quotes from Franz Fanon that I think are still relevant. "The settler's work is to make even dreams of liberty impossible for the native. The native's work is to imagine all possible methods for destroying the settler. During the period of colonization, the native never stops achieving his freedom. From 9 in the evening until 6 in the morning." So I guess the president of the American University let us know that it's 6 in the morning. Time to wake up. Thank you. Operator person that is also a sculptor, and he helps the school out, so I might be doing them a favor to like keep it in this warehouse for a minute for a while. I'm not sure.
You're not informing the reporter.
No.
Given that you had a contract with them, which probably included, or you'll have to illustrate this for us, for a certain period of time, right?
Right.
And then the work would be returned to you after that period, and that they had responsibility to safeguard it, I assume, and that it would not be moved without your express cooperation or assent. And the fact that it has quote disappeared from your consciousness, it seems among all the other travesties, you know, a real coup. That they won't tell you where it is. What is your recourse at this point?
Talk about the language in the loan agreement is that the statue will be there until the end of April. And that if either of the parties, the lender or the institution, wanted to change the length of the loan or the exhibition period, they would have to notify the other one in writing with 30 days notice. So I got an email on December 29th and the statue was gone on January 3rd. So they did not publicly oblige that. What I intend to do is to try and, you know, extract as high a cost as possible from the institution for this action. Since then, there's been a congressman that tore down a painting of a high school student in Congress. So just this morning, I was thinking of that Bertolt Brecht quote, you know, and adapting it. You know, first they came and took the sculpture, but it was a sculpture of a cop killer, so I didn't care. Then they came and took the painting, but it was the painting of a policeman dressed as a pig, or vice versa, so I didn't care. Now that they come for the ... So I'm hoping to like do as much as I can before we get to the part where I realize it was too late. I've got a legal counsel, and they are communicating with the university. The students are away. The students have been away for practically the entire time the sculpture was there. They're returning Monday, so we are now in communication with the president of the student body. There's people that want to go and lay flowers on the spot where the sculpture was and create like an altar. So we'll see what happens from now.
Do you have photographs of the work installed?
Yeah. There was a couple towards the end. They're not.
We saw them on the screen. But it occurred to me that if you had a large photo mural made, then. Install that in place of the sculpture. It certainly would irritate a few people, but someone would get to see it, sort of an image of what had been there, at least. And so that was taken down as well.
Well, this thing, there's obviously so much scholarship, in the last few decades about what happens to the native perspective, what happens to the native body, what happens to the native world, what happens to the native land. So this erasure, of I don't know how many statues there are in DC dedicated to Native people, but I'll volunteer my fingers, most towns and cities have sports teams, right? Yeah, it's a cool thing, sports. Well, the sports team from Washington, DC is called the Redskins. Can you imagine if they had a football team in Auschwitz called the Jews? That would be quite a thing to pull off in Germany. But it's called Redskins in DC. So even though I look the way I look, the way I got treated, it's like I felt like another Redskin in Washington, D.C. You know, that's what it made me feel like. Because I wrote a bunch of emails to these wonderful, nice, polite people that I've exchanged this, you know, experience with, and they were all super cordial, including the truck operator, the truck driver. Everybody was super nice. But then an order came to take the statue down, and you write to people, you call, and all of a sudden it's like you don't exist. That, I think, was kind of what hurt the most, because I'm a very, like, you know, direct contact with people. Some asshole university president, like, well, it doesn't surprise me. But the people that actually were there, you know, were like in sub-freezing temperatures, putting this thing together. That somebody says, sit! It becomes impossible to stand up. I don't know. At least, like, you know, get a photograph of yourself when you were standing up and mail it to me. Like, I remember it was possible. But, you know, so that hurt. That nobody would borrow a friend's phone or something and call me. Be like, look, shit hit the fan. But no, it's like, ciao, Bella. Okay. So anyway.
Are there any more interviews coming up, follow-up interviews, like what happened this past week? A fuller story of this? I don't get the sense from the reporting that I've seen that people really know what you're saying.
Well, I got a contact from this woman, Rebecca Pineda, and she works in an art space in Washington, D.C. called the Hamiltonians. And they want to sponsor, like, a conversation, you know, which is kind of obviously what should have happened. She's actually the development person. She was in a mountain when she called me. I got to talk to my boss. There won't be a problem raising the money for the airfare. Development person, and she was a student at AU, an undergrad, and she's just kind of like, she knows Jack Rasmussen very well. They're, you know, he helped her a lot, professionally, mentor. Like, my relationship with Jack was also outstanding. I mean, he went out of his way to make it possible to bring the statue there. So I know it's not coming from him. So I'm waiting to hear on the outcome of that. And also, since we contacted the president of the student union, who, by the way, is an African-American male, and one of the problems they've had at the American university is that young black girls and young black women who are going to school there are finding bananas in the doors of their dorm and things like that. So I think there's other issues going on at the AU. Yep.
I find it interesting that what started this kind of rapid chain of events of this decapitation and the removal of the painting, the platform of Fox News, the media, you know, which, you know, in both cases, was the starting point of them being removed quickly. The censorship kind of appalls me. That they follow suit after this media company brings attention to these.
And law enforcement agencies. Yeah, the president got a letter from the FBI, AA, Federal Bureau of Investigation Agents Association. And you know, they feel extremely strongly about Leonard's case and what the circumstances around it. So they wrote the president saying that they thought it was an offense to law enforcement to have this statue there. And they also said, you know, we believe in freedom of speech, but speech has consequences. kind of a chilling sentence. You're free to walk in front of the train, buddy. It is coming. Oh, we don't know when it comes, actually.
Other instances of censorship over the course of, you sort of showed us a span of work, and I wondered if you in different other political climates you had experienced anything similar.
I have, but with this work, never. I just spoke with Jeffrey Hoon, is the director of the Museums and Galleries of Syracuse University. And it reminded me that the reaction of Syracuse University was to purchase one of Leonard's paintings for $10,000. And there was no beef there. He's a supporter of the project. Richard Klein at the Aldrich Museum, they hosted the Tafel Kikwil Museum exhibit there. But I've had instances before and where there's been a similar kind of silence. Do you want me to share another example?
Sure.
This is a particularly painful one. There was San Francisco's UCSF. They built a new hospital, and it's an hospital for prenatal care, natal care, and oncology. And because to build a hospital is like super, super expensive, as you can imagine. So the percent for art program was considerable. And because I didn't want to put the artist through this kind of sometimes painful process of competing with your peers and all this stuff, so instead they invited people, they pre-fetted over the work. So they invited only people that already they had chosen, and I was one of the people invited to do a tile mural over this entrance. It was interesting because I had just come back from Mexico, spending 6 months in Mexico, working with Zapatista communities on there, and I was with my friend Santiago, and we arrived there to go do a visit to the construction site for the first time, and we were both wearing flip-flops, and you cannot go to a construction site on flip-flops, and we were met by the curator of the arts program, the liaison between the construction company and the artists, and the community liaison from between the community and the hospital. And they were all three women, and it was just this wonderful moment. We were just arriving back from Mexico and we're in San Francisco, the construction site, sitting down, and you have these three ladies looking at us, well, you won't be able to go in with those shoes, but don't worry, we'll get you the proper shoes. It was just like really wonderful. You know, and so they brought us boots, the girls flip-flops and put our boots off, and the five of us walked into the construction site, and they showed us where the spot was going to be. And Barbara, the woman who was the community liaison, she said, you know, this is the people's entrance in more ways than one. I'm doing something here, because there wasn't even going to be an entrance here. The hospital was going to have its back turned to 3rd Street, there's a metro station right there, Union Station. And so the whole hospital was turned into the parking lot, there's a heliport anyway. But the neighbors demanded, and the architects ended up putting a doorway, an entranceway there. And it just so happened I was going to do this mural above the, it's like a vestibule with glass on two sides anyway. It was a very big budget, so I was like, what? With that much I can do that wall and also this wall. Really? Yeah. Well, let me talk to the architect. So they like tripled the area, reinforced the wall. And I made a drawing and a sketch. And the sketch was based on a dear friend of mine, Eugenia. She actually painted this shirt. And Eugenia died of complications from breast cancer. And I was the first person she told when she was pregnant. So we have her friends. So I had a photograph of Eugenia pregnant with a straw hat, with a hat and a skirt. And, So I thought it would be perfect because of all the history of what the hotel was for, the hospital was for. So the image was a tall, pregnant woman, twice life size, holding a flower, and then there were four butterflies. Because the hospital in San Francisco is at 3rd Street and Mariposa. Mariposa is butterfly in Spanish. I found out that California, the biggest county in California was Mariposa County. The reason it was called Mariposa is because when the land surveyors were walking up this creek at the foothills of the Sierras, and they see like a cloud of butterflies, and they're like, whoa, Mariposa. So it became Mariposa Creek, became Mariposa County. But the county was so big that as California got more populated, it was divided into 12 other counties. So Mariposa County is known as the mother of all counties.
Mother County, oh, wow, man, you know.
Let's have these English-only speakers at least realize that Mariposa means this, you know? And, you know, self-identifying as a punk and all that. One sometimes wonders, I'm doing work with, like, butterflies and pregnant ladies, shit, I don't know. I'm not selling out yet, there's a reason for this. The CEO of UCSF had an issue with a pregnant woman. And he wanted the image removed. What I was told is that he was afraid the image might give the hospital an unfortunate nickname. I was never told anything else. So from being in this project where everybody involved were women, literally showed up this disembodied male voice from somewhere that said no. Actually, the liaison, the lady was liaison for the construction company, she was pregnant. Nobody stood up. I didn't do it. I would have, you know, it would have been nice if I had that money, but I didn't do it. They're like, what do you mean you're going to do while I'm swimming? Well, can I get a meeting with the person? It was impossible. It's very, very busy, man. So to the extent that he never even met the head curator. Weeks later, I go to Auckland in New Zealand, Aotearoa, with Emery Douglas, the Minister of Culture for the Black Panther Party, and we're there doing exhibits curated by Halpin Room. And during the opening at the Auckland Museum, the mayor of Auckland sang. Auckland, by the way, is a city with 2 million people. And the mayor sang a song in Maui, like, you know, as European look in this movie, you know. And I was like, what? Where am I? It was so incredible. And where Halpin Roo had us do our artwork was in, like, quote unquote, the boonies, you know, some flea market area where all the Polynesians hang out. And they're like, man, how come you feel so at ease here? Like, it looks just like the mission in San Francisco, you know. So when we did the dedication of where our artwork was, the mayor was not scheduled to come, but he showed up. The mayor of a city of 2 million people, and I was like, excuse me, like, I was so moved to hear you sing, you know, like, is it okay if we take a photograph together? And he's like, come. So I was photographed hugging with the mayor of Auckland, city of 2 million people that had time to meet with me. Whereas asshole CEO of UCSF was too busy, too important. But I said, well, I can make another sketch if you pay me a little bit more. So I made four versions of the fixed design. One was the very same one I had presented, and I defended that was the most significant one, better one. I presented four alternatives in order of preference. Because aside from the woman and the four butterflies, there's going to be a map of California showing all the counties, and the map of California showing all the native language groups and ethnic cultural groups. Also the life cycle of the butterflies. Because the Mariposa butterfly, the monarch butterfly is a very remarkable creature. So I submitted the same design. Another design was without the pregnant woman, but with this big map, because the territory, the monarch butterfly goes between Mexico and Canada. They fly, I don't know if you have time to tell this stuff, but anyway, you can find out. But these butterflies go from Mexico to Canada, takes them 3 generations to get there, and then 1 generation flies back. So the monarch butterfly's lifespan is 6 weeks, like a month and a half, and then the 4th generation lives 9 months. It's, I think, unparalleled in the animal world, you know. So you fly a little bit. They don't even fly, they flutter. So it had this map, this is the same map as the North American Free Trade Agreement. It's a territory, it's 4-inch wingspan animal. So it was another way of representing this landmass without the borders, right? And the butterfly goes, bye, bye. So one had that, and the other one had the four phases of a butterfly: egg, chrysalis, or cocoon, and butterfly. And then the 4th version was just a woman gone and just the 4 butterflies. And the CEO chose that version. And I was like, for me, it was like a psychology test. Let's see, is he a real asshole? If you are a real asshole, choose 4. And it came back, 4. And I was like, okay, I won't do it. But you can't, you gave us 4 examples and chose 1, you have to do it. I said, look, I couldn't talk to this person, he couldn't meet me. My only chance of learning a little bit more about him was this way. And now I'm elucidated. I will not do it. They asked Barry McGee to do it. Poor Barry probably has no idea what went on before. Anyway, so that's another example of censorship. Sorry if I get too animated. It's fun to get to tell this story. Mark Leray. I googled him. There's one point you can see him speaking at a podium and 4 nurses come and interrupt him with a megaphone. One of the first things he did as the CEO was to fire 300 nurses. He owns shares in pharmaceutical companies. I mean, it seems like one of those movies. But it's for real, you see a CSF San Francisco. I never found out. That's what was told. Like, what is it, you know?
Because if you would have found out, you could have come with us.
I couldn't, you know, the way she was dressed, you know, like Arab Renaissance, like time of the century, kind of like I thought was cool, you know, long skirt with flowers, and then a jacket and a shirt and a hat. You couldn't see her hair, so maybe she, it was early in the pregnancy, so maybe she could be bloated from
Persian.
It wasn't. So, I think maybe single mom, because it was just a woman without the dude or whatever. I don't know if that was it, or if it was like welfare mother, because she didn't look very fancy. She was wearing like Birkenstock type. I don't know, but the thing that got to me is like I never knew what this unfortunate nickname that he was so afraid to tell them I think it was. But, you know, and for me, it was really upsetting because having done these works with Geronimo and Robert King and Tommy Smith, like, okay, I'm going to get a chance to do a work with actually the image of a woman and not a guy, you know? And so it was like his meta-mother because she was twice as big, so I thought that you could walk out of the hospital with your baby and stand next to this woman where everybody would become a baby in terms of scale and relationship. That was kind of my thing. I thought people would take photos with it, and, you know. But I asked my gallery, I asked the curator, to write a letter to the guy, nobody would do this. And that was really crushing.
I was just wondering, what do you think Leonard's chances for clemency are right now? We're writing letters on his behalf. Are you hopeful, or how do you feel about it?
And that's one of those things where it's 50-50, you know. And when we keep trying to read the leaves on the tea, you know, which way it seems to be going, the most momentous thing that happened is that the judge in charge of the prosecution the person representing the United States against Leonard just signed on to the clemency campaign. And that's like the person in charge of, you know, that supervised the lawyer's team. You know, said enough is enough, 41 years, and let's just let this be. But remarkably, he also, when pressed, he also said he didn't go there with the intent to kill anybody. He went there to protect his people. And that's what's uncanny, because this what's going on in North Dakota is the very same thing. You know, Robert Redford got a Medal of Freedom from Obama. He started the Sundance Film Festival. Sundance are the dance, ceremonial dance that the Lakota perform, and Leonard is part of Lakota.
Harry Belafonte in public asked for his release.
Of course, Archbishop Desmond Tutu has been talking about it for a long time. I mean, I think it would be such a healing gesture, you know. And as a Democrat, you know, party politics, I think as a Democrat right now, they're not falling over with love for the FBI. So, you know, you would think like, maybe now there's a few circumstances that combined might make him do it. But we really don't know. It seems that it might be smart if you were to do it really late on, because then all the clout, all the noise about the inauguration and Trump, and there's only so much bandwidth in the news. It will definitely cement his legacy as an intercultural person, you know. I really hope that he does, because the alternative is despair, you know, between hope and despair. Like, we have a range of possibilities, but from my little experience with most Native people here, the ones that are living on the land, the territory between hope and despair is so little, so slim, that if they don't get hope, they will get is more despair. One thing that kind of came, you know, to me recently is like, I think you can judge most people's character by the way they treat their mothers, you know, most, to give a little room for whatever, but I think you can judge most people's character by the way they treat their mothers, and Native people are always talking about Mother Earth, you know, the way we behave, our relationship to Mother Earth, and there's different areas of knowledge, and different cultures derive their knowledge from different sources. As in so-called West, we turn to scientists, the scientific class. You know, the things that they say is the result of a pretty strenuous intellectual effort. Well, the scientists are telling us that mother is sick, that mother has a fever, that mother is losing a lot of her children, that mother's thawing at the edges. That's an hoax. A hoax made by the Chinese. That's what child Donald Trump thinks about the diagnostic that scientists made about mother's mom's health. That's what judges character. So that's the lunatic that's, you know, gonna be at the helm. So I think it will be bad for Leonard, it will be bad for Mother, it will be bad for a lot of people. And it's a small gesture that I really hope that Obama will do it, because there must be so many limitations to what we perceive as the power of somebody in a position like him. How close Guantanamo in 1 year? Oh shit, 8 years wasn't enough. Right? Close one prison, President of the United States of America. But granting clemency to one individual is something that he can do. That he can. he doesn't have to negotiate this and that and delete persecution, just along with everybody else said that he thinks he should be released. So anyway, I really hope it happens. And like Ethan mentioned, I've been told that that online petition through Amnesty International at this point is the most efficient way to communicate with the White House. They closed the comments line, is no longer open, and that there's a 2-week backlog on mail. I think this card will just make it in there. But, again,
it's a good video that Amnesty, it's a 3-minute video to get you the background, so you can post that on social media, it's on YouTube, for Leonard Peltier Statue Project, and combine that with posting the petition to get as many people to come in and sign it. That's what we're doing right now. Let's see how.
Thank you for your time and listening.